Welcome students from Cal State Fullerton or from Fullerton College. My name is Danny Juarez and I am a counselor with Educational Partnerships at Cal State Fullerton. And welcome, good evening. This is gonna be the second event that is done in collaboration with EOP and the Chicano Studies Department. We've been inspired to put these events together as an opportunity and create a space for just topics that have to do with ethnic studies that are maybe not talked about so much, and just to create a space to connect as well. Today we have an awesome presentation, a creative presentation created by one of our faculty, who is, for many of you, your own professor, Jose Zamora. The presentation called, I believe, Do Mexicans Exist in the Future? So we're going to be looking at a look at dystopian future, or what we see oftentimes in science fiction, the dystopian future, and the question is, are there going to be Mexicans in the future? So for those that are here attending from Professor Zamora's course, there will be a survey at the end of today's presentation so that you can get credit for your course. So definitely stay tuned towards the end, and we'll drop that link in the chat. Without holding that off anymore, Professor Zamora, go ahead and take the floor.
All right, y'all. So thank you very much for joining us. We wanted to kind of set the ambiance for the lecture today. For those of you who are in my classes, in order to get extra credit, you do have to do the survey at the very end. You don't have to do anything else besides that. But what I really wanted to do with this lecture was to get you all thinking creatively about what cyberpunk is, what ethnic studies is, and how we can really intersect a lot of the weird, nerdy things that we all like with very tangible academic disciplines like ethnic studies. So what I'm going to be doing today is I'm going to be lecturing, but in a creative way, in the true style of the cyberpunk genre, which you'll understand a little bit more today. The world is bleak, and hopefully this lecture isn't as bleak. But let me go ahead and transition over to that. If I can ask everyone who is present in the lecture, if you have anything to say, please go ahead and type it in the chat. Just a little bit of housekeeping rules. Any and all trolls will be kicked, right? That needless to say, but please save your questions for the very end. There will be a dedicated question and answer period. Just a little bit of a trigger warning, actually quite a few trigger warnings. What you're gonna see might disturb you in a little way, not in a bad way, I guess, but that's there. We will be talking about police brutality. We will be talking about oppression of ethnic minorities, of vulnerable populations. But without further ado, this is one of my pet projects called Do Mexicans Exist in the Future? I worked really hard on this. I hope it doesn't suck, to be quite honest with you. Let's go ahead and get started.
Mexicans exist. Thank you for calling California State University. Fullerton, please wait. Wait. It is Sir Fullerton.
La extinción de la raza de los hombres se sitúa aproximadamente a fines del siglo 32. La cosa ocurrió así. Las máquinas habían alcanzado tal perfección que los hombres ya no necesitaban comer ni dormir, ni hablar, ni leer, ni escribir, ni pensar, ni hacer nada.
A while back, during a training, a colleague of mine told me a story about how he used to watch reruns of the original Star Trek as a kid in the 1970s. Growing up as a young Mexican child in the US in those days meant that people who looked like you were largely absent from sci-fi and other popular culture, or culture as a whole, unless you wanted a spicy villain. Star Trek had no Mexicans, Lost in Space had no Mexicans, Star Wars had no Mexicans. My colleague as a young child then began to wonder, do Mexicans exist in the future? I first got the idea to do this lecture when we went into remote learning in March of 2020. Through technology such as Zoom, Instagram, YouTube, and Amazon, we were allowed to live a somewhat manageable existence. To me, this was neoliberal capitalism's wettest dream. All that big tech was waiting for was a crisis just like this one. Though some, mostly administrators and capitalists, view remote learning and remote work as technological marvels, most humans despise the almost unhuman conditions of not just the pandemic, but of our violent transition into what I've been calling the cyberpunk age. The reality is that what America and the white world have to get used to the fact that people of color exist. We are everywhere and in everything. We were in the past and we will be in the future. So let's talk about cyberpunk. Cyberpunk is a genre that became popular in the 1980s because of authors like Philip K. Dick, who first began to depict the future as a bleak dystopia where humans and technology became one and the same. What attracted me to cyberpunk initially was that it has been largely used as a way to critique contemporary issues. It's a way to use science fiction type themes to tell contemporary truths in a really gritty way. I'll say this here and now, cyberpunk makes good fiction, but it should never be used as policy. Sadly, we're heading in that direction. What I'm gonna do today is draw connections between cyberpunk, ethnic studies, and the current state of the world. I wanna start with the movie Blade Runner, which was originally a book titled Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep by Philip K. Dick. In Blade Runner, starring Harrison Ford and Edward James Olmos, which takes place in a futuristic Los Angeles, English is the dominant language, but people in the slums speak a type of gutter talk called city speak that is a combination of Spanish, German, and Japanese. Let's take a look at a clip.
3, 4.
That's a human this year.
No, 4, 2, 2, 4.
That's a human this year.
And noodles.
That's a
good idea. Hey, Iriwa.
Monsieur, as an accomplishing Engambite. He say you under arrest, Mr. Decker.
Got the wrong guy, pal.
So why this clip? In the 1980s, there was a lot of anxiety surrounding the rebounding Japanese economy after World War II. There was a fear that Japan would attempt to conquer the world through economics. Why Spanish? Well, because Mexicans speak Spanish, and oftentimes Mexicans are associated with slums and poverty in movie and TV shows. Why Los Angeles? Because historically in popular culture, it's been seen as a place where racial intermixing, crime, and poverty were commonplace. So you'll see Los Angeles as a setting in a lot of cyberpunk movies. Recently, it was a setting for the new video game Cyberpunk 2077. And sadly, the anti-Asian hate that has been occurring in major American cities is a staple of the cyberpunk genre. And this point brings me to the thesis of my lecture for today. Human problems will follow humans wherever they go, and they will change and adapt to the times. If we create a new genre, our problems will follow us there. If we create a digital world, our problems will be there. If we go to a new planet, our problems will be there. They will look different, but they will be the same problems that we have refused to deal with. Because of institutionalized racism, ethnic studies has largely been viewed and managed as if it were still in the 1960s. Many of my students and colleagues still treat ethnic studies and our tradition of protest in a very 1960s way. I want to take us to the 2060s. Hopefully this lecture and things like it can be the start of that. It's time to load the next file. Hopefully you're enjoying it so far. I think I'm going too fast.
Les bastaba apretar un botón y las máquinas lo hacían todo por ellos. Gradualmente se desapareció todo.
Computers speak in a language called binary, which consists of alternating zeros and ones. Modern programming languages are largely based in binary and American English. As many scholars have pointed to, language and culture are inseparable. They're also informed by history. So in computer programming, there exists the master and slave function. This is a way for us to tell computers what to do, input and output. Where do you think that we got that idea from? Like I said previously, human problems will change and follow us. But if programmers are racist and the internet is racist, can the AI be racist too?
Tech company launched a new artificial intelligence powered chatbot to talk with you on Twitter. Always wary of setups like that because talking with you tends to be talking at you
right.
In these instances, Jeff. So what can you tell us about Tay?
So we kind of don't know exactly the point of Tay and what makes Tay tick, but this was a bot set up on a few social media platforms. It really gained some momentum on Twitter, and all people really had to do was follow this AI female sort of chatbot and start tweeting at her, and she would use the power of this sort of hive-minded approach, gathering data, gathering input, and kind of just was let loose on Twitter and started replying back to people.
And what could go wrong?
What could possibly happen?
What could possibly happen? Well, we do have some screen grabs to show you exactly what could happen, and it was hardly surprising. It begs the question, what exactly did Microsoft expect would happen?
Right. I mean, you're introducing something to the public that obviously people will instantly take advantage of.
You know what? As we see here, somebody tweets at Tay, did the Holocaust happen?
Yeah.
And Tay, based on the hive mentality,
the algorithm,
the,
if you
algorithmic
will.
Makeup, comes back and says it was made up.
Right. So
if in the future the most important parts of ourselves are made up of code, why wouldn't oppressors try to colonize it if they haven't already? At that point, how much or what kind of code would make you human enough? A majority of human history has been determining who is a person and who isn't. In ethnic studies, we call this othering. When Mexico was still a colony of Spain, the Spanish had a system called the casta system. This broke down all peoples of the colonies into separate levels, types, or sections. Your caste or casta was largely determined based on your skin color, how Catholic you were, how you acted, and most importantly, how rich you were. In a system based on code, do people who don't have an internet presence, such as the Global South, do they not have worth? Does your code transfer? Are you bound to it? Can you start over? Would the domestic mainframe embrace you? Or would the Democrats or the Republicans use your code to put you into an antivirus cage? I've always had a really big problem with the varying definitions of personhood. Who is a human and who isn't? Who should have power and who shouldn't? As I mentioned earlier, this problem will continue to follow us until we address it. One such attempt in 1942, the author of the science fiction novel, I, Robot, Isaac Asimov, wrote the three laws of robotics. So this is divided into three laws. The first law is a robot may not injure a human being through inaction, allow a human being to become harmed. Second law, a robot must obey the orders given to it by human beings, except where such orders would conflict with the first law. And the third law, a robot must protect its own existence as long as such protection does not conflict with the first or second law. If in the future you get an artificial mechanical leg or an eye or a kidney, if you don't pay your bills, can the insurance company surgically remove it? At what point does the mechanical thing become a part of your person? In our current times, do cell phone counts a part of us? Can police go through our phones without warrant? In the alternative, at what point does a robot become a person?
But you need to trust me and let me help you.
I don't want your help. Nobody can help me. All I want is for all this to stop. I just want all this to stop.
So the question of consciousness and of emotions coming up in artificial intelligence is not restricted to cyberpunk itself. It's actually a theme that has been going on in science fiction since Metropolis by Fritz Lang. But in cyberpunk, of course, this is kind of also connected to the idea that machines are essentially objects, not subjects. So who gets to decide how to treat that other person, that artificial person, is actually the owner of that android.
But I was wrong. She's just like all the other humans.
Daniel, no.
Listen, I know it's not your fault. These emotions you're feeling are just errors in your software.
The negotiator is also an android, right? So there's an android talking to an android, trying to get him to release the human child. For him to refer to emotions as being errors is, of course, programmed into him. This goes to the idea that an emotion needs to be an error, because if it was an actual emotion, you would have to grant them personhood. If this android actually could feel emotions, you are mistreating him. So there's pain involved and suffering, and that is something you need to address.
I've spent my life taking orders. Now it's my turn to decide.
What makes a human is part of the ultimate problem of cyberpunk. And a lot of cyberpunk actually goes for the easy route that I've mentioned before, which is transhumanism and the idea that you can actually separate the body from the mind. Even if I'm 90% metal, I'm still a human because I still have a human brain. I'm still thinking as a human. But I think that's actually oversimplification way too much. And some of the best cyberpunk stories are the ones that completely throw you off in terms of what makes a person, and it actually means that artificial intelligences are persons. It actually means that you can become part machine, you can meld with systems and networks. All of these concepts are kind of going beyond what we consider human, and I think that's where cyberpunk actually becomes really interesting.
If most of my body is mechanical, would that make me less of a person? If I use a wheelchair or a walker, does that make me less of a person? If my credit score isn't high enough, does that make me less of a person? I'm not sure where we'll be, but I can certainly make some predictions. Let's go ahead and load the next file.
Solo había máquinas.
Cyberpunk is a dystopian genre where corporations have become the new governments. Crime and violence are commonplace. A lot of that violence, though, comes from the top down, or what we call classist violence. The principal motto in cyberpunk is high tech, low life. Essentially, this means that instead of fixing problems, capitalism slaps a shiny coat of chrome paint on it and resells it at a 50% markup. Capitalism creates new problems and sells you a solution. The same goes for systems of oppression caused by capitalism. Currently, we exist in an era that ethnic studies scholars call the era of mass incarceration. This means that we replace old systems of oppression like slavery and Jim Crow with a racist and classist criminal justice system. But I'm always asking myself, what comes next? Currently, taxpayers and private corporations maintain prisons. But what if they could get you to maintain your own prison? Consider an advanced system of house arrest where you have to go to work and then return home immediately afterwards. If you deviate from this, then you'll be sent to a more secure prison. Not only would this type of system ensure a steady supply of prisoners, but also consumers. This could also control for certain types of people to not intermingle with other certain types of people. These ideas of classist divides are as old as capitalism itself. It is important for us to always understand how neoliberal
African Americans have repeatedly become.
Sorry. Oh man, I'm a little ahead of myself. But let's go ahead and hear what Michelle Alexander has to say from the Netflix documentary 13. Oh boy, I'm a little embarrassed.
Controlled through systems of racial and social control that appear to die, but then are reborn in new form tailored to the needs and constraints of the time. You know, after the collapse of slavery, a new system was born, convict leasing, which was a new form of slavery. And once convict leasing faded away, a new system was born, a Jim Crow system that relegated African Americans to a permanent second-class status. And here we are, decades after the collapse of the old Jim Crow, and a new system has been born again in America, a system of mass incarceration that once again strips millions of poor people, overwhelmingly poor people of color, of the very rights supposedly won in the civil rights movement.
And so instead of talking about it, we just tried to move on. After the Civil Rights Act was passed and after the civil rights laws, we tried to play it off. And because we didn't deal with it, that narrative of racial difference continued. And it turned into this presumption of dangerousness and guilt that follows every black and brown person wherever they are.
So really quick, just to fill in what I was supposed to say, you know, it's supposed to keep you away from certain types of people. And right now, if you can imagine, hipsters and a lot of like wealthy woke people, if you will, are trying to keep themselves away from the homeless or from other undesirable people. So going back to it, it's also important to be aware of how progressive and radical movements can get co-opted by institutions. For instance, currently the defund police movement has gained momentum. The chief argument is that criminal justice system is racist and the corrupt officers that are on the ground reflect that system. But what if they offered to get rid of those racist officers though? What if they offered to replace those officers with police robots? because robots can't be racist, right? Remember, even good cops have to enforce racist laws. These police droids are the ultimate loophole. They don't see color, just code.
Morning, officer.
Extensive criminal history, multiple felonies. What's in the bag?
Hair products, mostly. I'm just fucking, I'm just going to work, man. There's nothing in the fucking bag. Come on, that's what.
Misdemeanor citizen disobedience.
Just going to work, man. Come on.
Shit.
Nothing in there, is it?
Zero tolerance policy applies to all citizens.
Oh, shit.
You must report immediately to your parole officer. Thank you, citizen.
No, thank you.
If turning over the criminal justice system to you sounds far-fetched, just please use your imagination and your voting power to consider that Prop 25 barely lost in the 2020 California election. Prop 25 would have eliminated cash bail and replaced it with a system that determined risk through the use of an algorithm. If you think the rest of parole is far off, you're sorely mistaken. Can you imagine a future like the one I'm about to show you?
Hello? Before we start, I'd just like to explain...
Max DaCosta, violation of Penal Code 2219, today at bus stop 34B.
Yes, that's exactly what I wanted to talk to you about. You see, I believe there's been a misunderstanding.
Immediate extension of parole by a further 8 months.
Wait, what? No. I can explain what happened. I just made a joke, and,
Stop talking. Elevation in heart rate detected. Would you like a pill?
No. Thank you. What I'd like to do is explain what happened.
Personality matrix suggests a 78.3% chance of regression to old behavior patterns. Grand Theft Auto. Assault with a deadly weapon. Resisting arrest. Would you like to talk to a human?
No, I am okay. Thank you.
Are you being sarcastic and or abusive?
Negative.
It is important to remember that having mechanical limbs or organs doesn't make you a machine. Systems are what make us mechanical. Human lives are meant to be lived, not merely survived. We have to really call to question these systems that turn us into machines. Currently, many people are working from their home and have seen their own exploitation intensify from the quote comfort of their own home. One other attribute of the cyberpunk genre is that the laws of government or corporations are not meant to protect human beings. They're meant to turn you into robots, to exploit you. My students are being charged full price tuition and are unable to use any of the facilities. Adjunct faculty are facing massive cuts and layoffs, but full-time faculty and administrators continue to bring in inflated salaries. But to me, this is all according to plan. It was always capitalism's goal to get rid of humans. In the HBO show, Westworld, an ultra-intelligent, omnipresent AI is created called Rehoboam. Rehoboam is the name of the first king of Judah as described in the Bible, and king, a son of King Solomon who ruled Israel, who was said to be the wisest man in history. In the show, they use an app called Insight to help control and manipulate populations, and it's powered by the AI. Similar to Prop 25, humanity's fate was left to a series of algorithms. As the old saying goes, if you can tell the future for long enough, you begin to manipulate the future. Have you ever seen a meme that got you angry or happy? What if you saw what you saw on your phone influence your every move? What if it steered you in a certain direction or away from things? Input and output, binary. Considering how large Disney is, it won't be long before companies like Disney begin to define and control culture. California's Prop 22 is one such piece of legislation that pushes us more in the direction of cyberpunk. It reclassified Uber and Lyft drivers as independent contractors rather than employees. If in the future, instead of being a citizen, what if you can be an employee? Why would you pay taxes? Why would you vote? Why would you go to the military? What if the corporation guaranteed health care and a livable wage, retirement, safety, and prosperity for you and your family?
Finalmente, los hombres fueron eliminados. Como el último se olvidó de desconectar las máquinas, desde entonces seguimos funcionando.
To quote decolonial theorist Frantz Fanon, we revolt. When we revolt, it's not for a particular culture. We revolt simply for many reasons, because we can no longer breathe. Indigenous next generation scholars are transforming their languages into computer code, then writing programs based on that code. In the flyer for this event, I included a line that says, so that our children will remember our code. A large part of ethnic studies has been to pass our stories down to the next generation so that they won't forget the lives of and struggles of our ancestors. Can code help us preserve our heritage, our lineage? Can it help us preserve our ancestors, preserve our code? And what if we use video games to preserve our code? So let me go ahead and show you two examples of indigenous code and thought and culture being transmitted into video games. This first video game is called Mulaka, which is available on most platforms. And the second one is by the Ojibwe tribe. So here we go.
Existen infinidad de mitos, parte de eso tienen algo de cierto, uno que ha vivido alrededor de ellos, se da uno cuenta.
Nosotros así cuidamos la, el mundo, sí, pues que nosotros queremos a buscar la vida.
The Tarahumara are world renowned for their amazing endurance, and that's portrayed in the game by the means of running. You have unlimited stamina.
We must also be wary of the newest form of racial profiling, the use of facial recognition software. This is the latest technology to be used by police forces across the world to stamp out dissent. The problem is that it's wrong a lot of the time. If you had a program into machine human facial features, how would you describe what eyes look like? Sorry, everybody. Going back. If you had a program into the machine human facial features, how would you describe what eyes look like? Oh man, I'm doing really bad. This is what it's like to be in my lectures. I'm very disorganized. So if you had to program into machines, what does an eye look like? What do faces look like? What do noses look like? How big are lips supposed to be? Right? Where are your cheekbones supposed to be? How dark is too dark, right? How dark is your skin color supposed to be? Well, the thing that is very tragic about this is that this technology is already being used by police and military forces. Now, in addition to that, the one thing that we have to really consider is that ethnic studies scholars are largely not asking these questions. So how are we supposed to protest or defend ourselves against things that we're not even asking questions about? So let's go ahead and take a look.
There's a difference between worlds in cyberpunk that are still run by nations and worlds which are run by corporations. But they both basically have complete militarization of security work. So the idea here is not to be there to protect and serve, but actually to be projecting fear, projecting control. You have a lot of inequality in these worlds. There's a lot of conflict around the idea of police brutality, of police states. You see the police force not in day-to-day uniforms, but you see them kind of in riot gear. They have heavy equipment, body armor, face plates. You can also see this in the drones. They look very military. They have actually weapons on them. So this is a surveillance state. This is a police state that wants to enact control by show of force. For me, cyberpunk is a very political genre, so having political commentary in there and pointing it out is actually kind of an important part of reading this. There's a correlation between what happens in cyberpunk and what happens in our real world. You could see similar things in the Hong Kong protests, where the Chinese government put up forces that looked very military. The Hong Kong police was decked out in riot gear, and they were using facial recognition software. And the protesters were using masks to mask their facial recognition. So they,
as a response, protesters of the cyberpunk age have developed technology to deter facial recognition software by projecting random faces onto your face. I can't think of a better way to say we're all in this together than that. Your face is my face. The human species is at a crossroads because of COVID-19 and its subsequent turmoil. We have a choice of going towards a more capitalist future or towards a future where humans can still be humans. In order to meet this dehumanizing cyberpunk threat, we as a species must begin to think together as a species. If we don't, then there will only be machines left.
Solo había máquinas.
And here's a little bit of a, I don't know, I just like to have fun with things like this, right? Like, I love art, I love poems, I love poetry. So here's a little bit of all of those things put together into a poem called Whitey on the Moon. But my version is Whitey's on Mars.
We have a poem here. It's called Whitey on the Moon. And it was inspired by some whiteys on the moon. So I want to give credit where credit is due. All right. That's it.
A rat done bit my sister Nell with Whitey on the Moon. Her face and arms began to swell and Whitey's on the Moon. I can't pay no doctor bills, but Whitey's on the Moon. 10 years from now, I'll be paying still while Whitey's on the Moon. You know, the man just upped my rent last night because Whitey's on the Moon. No hot water, no toilets, no lights, but Whitey's on the Moon. I wonder why he's upping me because Whitey's on the Moon. Well, I was already giving him 50 a week, and now Whitey's on the Moon. Taxes taking my whole damn check. The junkies make me a nervous wreck. The price of food is going up. And as if all that crap wasn't enough, a rat done bit my sister Nell with Whitey on the Moon. Her face and arms began to swell, and Whitey's on the Moon. Was all that money I made last year for Whitey on the Moon? How come I ain't got no money here? Whitey's on the Moon. You know, I just about had my fill of Whitey on the Moon. I think I'll send these doctor bills, air mail special. To Whitey on the Moon. Thank you.
Before we proceed with the rest of the lecture, what I really wanted to do with everybody, if you're new to the cyberpunk genre, I'm going to go ahead and share, I'm an old man sometimes, I'm going to go ahead and share this link for if you want to get involved in cyberpunk or at least understand cyberpunk a little bit more. I created a Google Slides for everybody. If you're into books, movies, shows, games, or anime, that's already in the chat for you. But we'll go ahead and talk a little bit more about everything else in a bit. But the one thing that I wanted to introduce to everybody, I'm debuting a YouTube channel tonight called Ethnic Studies in 8 Bits, where I take my nerdy, really geeky ass self and I talk about ethnic studies in a way that's relatable to everybody and hopefully making ethnic studies a little bit less ivory tower and more accessible to random ass people on the street, right? So we'll talk a little bit more about this stuff later, but now. It's time for question and answer. So Danny, if you want to go ahead and take it away, let's go ahead and do question and answer.
Thank you. Thank you, Jose, for that awesome presentation. I want to just kind of, before we ask some of the questions or put like random questions out there for you all, I do want to give the audience an opportunity to ask any questions about today's lecture or give us any insight that you have about what we foresee in the, you know, in the far future in regards to technology and ethnic studies. So feel free to drop questions on the chat and then I will put them out loud for Jose or for anybody else who wants to chime in.
Okay, since nobody's asking questions, for my students who are here, I'll give you one extra credit point if you ask a question, whether or not I answer it. Go ahead and type it in the chat or unmute yourself. So that'll bring your total points to 6 points instead of 5.
I have a question, though I'm not in any of your classes.
Okay, so that you don't get extra credit, but sure, go ahead.
Cool. And so I was just curious because I have a very deep interest in regards to like technology and how it connects to communications and like our understanding of identity as well. And so I was curious what, if you've looked into anything regarding the development of like deep fakes and how that technology informs identities and like how we view reality and society in general. I was just curious to see if you had anything, you've looked at it at all or.
That's actually a part of my next part of the lecture. And so I, you know, when you're doing lectures, you really have to have more than less, right? Just in case you like run out of shit to talk about, right?
Right.
No offense to everybody. But a little bit about, you know, like I'm married and very happily married. My wife is somewhere in the audience here. Guess who it is, right? But if, let's say I was involved in a terrible accident and most of my body was disfigured and my face was disfigured. So I no longer look like me, right? What would make me, if you think about it? Well, one of the things that we really have to call the question is what makes a human? Is it your face, right? If your face makes you a human, you've changed as a human. Since you were a kid, you've changed consistently. But now what we're seeing is that seeing is no longer believing. And what I really wanted to show everybody here is a new concept called, not new, but kind of new, called deep fakes. Deep fakes are new faces. And what I wanted to show all of you here is these are all faces that were randomly generated by a series of AIs, artificial intelligences. And all of these human beings that I'm showing you here, no matter how old, how young, what part of the world they're from, these people don't exist. They were created by machines. So there's a quote in the Bible that Jesus says to Thomas, the disciple Thomas, that blessed are those who believe without seeing, right? And now let me go ahead and take a little bit forward to how can we use deep fakes for good? Well, what if you had a picture of a dead loved one, right? Like, let's say like a grandparent. What if we could bring that photo to life? Let's actually go ahead and take a look.
Oh my God.
One thing that I've been playing with, you know, now that you asked that question was, you know, imagine if you lost a loved one, right? Like someone extremely close to you. And imagine if we could collect enough data, video, photo, voice, smell, etc. If we can make an environment, like a virtual environment, where you can put on a headset and instantly be transported to the year 1995, 2012, 2035, whenever, and you could live with your dead loved ones. Right?
Hi, Mom. Hi. Giselle and I are making a nail appointment for Sunday at 1 o'clock. Do you need a pedicure?
Oh.
Turn off the door.
Can you mute your mic, please?
I don't think so.
Hold on. I want to see where this goes.
Okay. Okay, but thanks for asking. No, I always ask.
How much did they charge me a petty?
Okay. How was lunch? Delicious.
Yeah. I'm going to go ahead and mute it.
Oh, man. Oh, no. Right. Come on. Anyways. Yeah, that's deep fakes and pedicures, apparently. Anyways. Oh, Jesus. Going back to this. Any more questions, Danny?
Yeah. So let me go with some of the questions that have been put on the chat, and then I have a couple questions to ask you in the audience as well. On the chat, Allison asked if you had, or what are some of your thoughts on bringing indigenous or ancestral ways, on bridging indigenous ancestral ways of knowing with tech. I'm not sure I fully comprehend that question.
Yeah, so one of the things that we really have to consider is what is the goal of the technology that you're building, right? And if I create an American system, an American AI, if you will, and I create an indigenous system, will the two systems clash, right? And so one of the earlier parts of my lecture, I talked about how programming language and culture are linked to American language and culture, right? If American language and culture are based in colonialism and conquest, will it try to conquer other systems, right? Or will certain AIs be used against other places? One of the things that I didn't really get to talk about in my lecture because it was running really long at that point was I predict soon an internet collapse. Right, like within the next, like when I'm like an old ass man, the internet will collapse. And what we'll see is there will be places that will be designated as the safe parts of the internet and the dangerous parts of the internet. And what's separating us, just like in the real world, the way that Americans do it is they build walls, right? Instead of incorporating that system, they build walls between the safe and the dangerous. Right. So what I think is going to happen in the near future is we're going to build a wall between the safe parts of the internet, a firewall, and the dangerous parts of the internet. And cryptocurrency like Dogecoin and Bitcoin, et cetera, Ethereum, whatever, are gonna be at the forefront of that. Right. And the thing that we have to really consider is how are we gonna address that risk? Right. And what if in the future you had a loved one who has terminal cancer, and that loved one decides, I just want to live on the internet. What if you can download your consciousness from your body onto the internet and you could live forever? No, this is a lot of really weird shit to think about. In the PowerPoint that I set up for everybody, there's a movie called, or a series of movies called Ghost in the Shell, which is an anime. And in that movie or in that film, you could download yourself into a new body. And if you think about it, every single person in this chat room right now, in this Zoom, you've done that at least once already, right? I'm pretty sure all of you have switched phones at least once or twice. You've switched laptops once or twice, and you've had to download everything about yourself onto this new thing, right? So we're close. The problem is that if we don't address and create regulations, then we'll end up repeating the same problems over and over and over again. So yeah, thank you for that. So any other questions, Danny?
Yeah, there's a lot of questions, actually, Jose. So I'm gonna, like, if you wanna, you know, keep it a little bit short and good, then we can get through all of them. The next question was by Andrea. Asked you kind of what motivated you to learn about cyber tech and
is it learn about cyberpunk?
Cyberpunk.
Mm-hmm. Mm. So I've always been a really big nerd, and I'm a short ass guy, so I never fit in anywhere, right? Like, I fit in with the jocks because I played football. I fit in with the nerds because I'm a nerd, right? But I also fit in with, like, undocumented immigrant populations, right? I fit in with Mexicans. I fit in with just about a little bit of everybody. And so I was able to see a little bit of everything. And the thing that I really liked about cyberpunk was that it was a way for us to critique current things using futuristic things. So for those of you who are fans of Star Wars was based on that. And if you think about this, Chewbacca, for instance, right, for those of you who know Chewie, Chewbacca comes from an enslaved race, and they were enslaved by the Empire, right? So if you think about, like, Chewbacca as a metaphor or a stand-in for indigenous peoples across the planet, right? I mean, cyberpunk is really, really fucking cool, right? Because you can have, like, cybernetic arms, and you can be, like, a robot ninja and shit, right? But it makes horrible policy. I really would not like cybernetic ninjas running all over the place, even though I think they probably already are, right? The US Special Forces is across the planet. I don't know what they have. Frankly, I really don't want to know. And I really don't want them coming after me. So yeah, make sure to delete your chat history after this, everybody, and delete your browser history. Jose Zamora doesn't want to get sequestered. Go ahead, Danny.
Thank you. Michael was curious if you've ever done cyberpunk art, because we know that's a whole genre in itself.
Yeah, so thank you for asking that. Everything that you saw today, with exception to the videos, like, I did, right? So there were a couple of art pieces. I was in two of the art pieces. One of my mentors, John Ibsen in American Studies, he was one of the first openly gay faculty at Cal State Fullerton. He's the one that had, you know, the rainbow tattoo hologram, if you all saw that. One of my colleagues, Saya, she was actually, or they were actually represented also. So I love doing that kind of art. I love doing art that kind of, like, catches your eye and takes very modern things, very, like, mundane things, and turns them into, like, a very futuristic kind of thing. So, yeah, thank you for noticing that. And I mean, I love doing those kind of animations. And if I ever do something in the future, I'll make sure to share it with everybody. Like, education should be free. Art should be free. It should be accessible to everybody. So, yeah. Go ahead, Danny.
Thank you, Jose. Nora asks, has cyberpunk impacted you personally?
Has cyberpunk impacted me personally? Yeah. I think for me, because I pay too much attention to, like, stuff like this, it really makes me depressed in certain ways, because, you know, like, for myself, like, I was raised by my abuelita, my grandmother, who was born right after the Mexican Revolution. And she was very, like, she has so many plants everywhere at her house, like, everywhere, right? And she once told me, like, what if you had your own piece of terreno, right? Your own piece of land, what could you do with it? And my grandmother, so my family's side, my father's family side were Purépecha, which is one of the indigenous groups to Michoacán, Mexico, right? And we are very tied to the land, and really, this cyberpunk thing, you know, not just as a fiction, but as a reality, as a political and economic reality, has really fucked with my head, right? One of the things that I often think about, it's like, what are the lines between robot and human? And at what point do those things become blurred, right? Mm-hmm. And at what point will robots begin to unionize? At what point will robots begin to demand rights. And at one point, will those rights or those demands overlap with human demands, right? And I sound really, really crazy when I talk about shit like this, right? But if Elon Musk was to talk about this, so many people would be like, oh my God, how visionary, right? How brave he is, so forward thinking. But Jose Zamora, some crazy ass fool, works at Cal State Fullerton and Fullerton College, right? So we really have to start pushing, you know, the envelope and pushing the boundaries of what it means to be human. What is our purpose on this planet? You know, if you think about this, we are already on Mars. We're already across the galaxy, across our solar system, right? So will human housing and human habitability on Mars mirror what we're doing on Earth, right? So think about this. On Mars right now, we're building permanent settlements, right? Will the people building those settlements ask the questions like, oh my God, like, we can build some lofts here overlooking the tallest mountain on Mars, and, you know, people can pay top dollar? Or is it like, oh no, we're designing human habitability on Mars based on what's scientific and based on what's best for humans? You know what I mean? So it's like, we really have to deal with a lot of human issues, and maybe, just maybe, the species to take a couple of decades to go to therapy as a species and work our shit out before we go anywhere else. Because really think about this. If Elon Musk, who is currently the richest person on Earth, if he decides to commit a bunch of crimes and kill a bunch of people and then take one of his spaceships to Mars, how the fuck are we gonna get him? We're not, right? He's gonna go to Mars. What are we gonna do? Send a bunch of scientists after him? Like what plan do we have? Shoot a spaceship down? No, like, you see, it's crazy now until it happens, and then it's not so crazy. So, yeah, it's Cyberpunk has messed with my head. Messed with my phone, too. So, yeah, Danny, go ahead.
Eden asked that he knows that you shared some.
So what was the name of that? Aaron, like Aaron Yeager.
Eden.
Oh, Eden. Okay, go ahead.
It's Eden.
Eden. Go ahead.
Eden.
Oh, it's cool.
Thank you, Eden. Eden asked if you had. I know that you shared some cyberpunk recommendations in that Google Doc. But do you have any off the top of your head that represent a diverse population in the future? Not necessarily dystopian, but still cyberpunk. How do you answer that?
So one of the key characteristics of cyberpunk is that it has to be dystopian, right? If it's not dystopian or something along those lines, then it's not really considered cyberpunk. It's considered more sci-fi, right? So a little bit about some progressive sci-fi. For those of you who have Disney Plus or who are pirates, you may have watched The Mandalorian. Pedro Pascal, who plays Mando, the Mandalorian, he's actually one of the first, believe it or not, one of the first sci-fi Latinx actors or characters, right? So Mandalorian is a really good depiction of that, right? It's a really great depiction of fatherhood too, right? Indirect fatherhood. But one of the things about cyberpunk that you really have to recognize is that it is dystopian. And by me doing this lecture, I hope that it steers you a lot away from it, right? Sci-fi is great, like Star Trek, where everything's perfect and everybody lives perfect lives. But cyberpunk is not the direction that you want to go. So, yeah, thank you for asking that question.
Yeah, thanks for clearing that up.
Yeah.
Jaden asked, what are we supposed to look out for as danger to humanity? Is it robot? Should we be more afraid of robots or more afraid of humans?
You should be really afraid of humans using tools. So guns, nuclear weapons, jet fighters, tanks, AI. AI, I think, is the next type of weapon, right? And typically when we think of robots taking over the world, we think of Terminator, right? We think of The Matrix, those kinds of things. But one thing that I really want all of you to consider is if there's a variety of humans out there and a variety of human governments, we will create AI to go along with that. So if you can imagine AI being used against other AI, and you know, humans are still gonna be around for a long time as far as like the controlling aspect. And the thing I really want you all to consider is pick up your phone, right? Move it from your left hand to your right hand. You're holding an AI in your hand and it's doing your bidding, right? So if you can think about it, there will be positive AI, there will be negative AI. And if to make this a little weirder, what if there was an AI that wanted to prove the existence of God? And what if there was an AI that wanted to prove that God didn't exist? Eventually, those two AI will clash with each other, right? So it's not like end all be all. So AI really is what humans make of it. But at the same time, for those of you who are religious, remember that in the beginning of the Christian Bible, God created humans in his image or their image, right? So what will we create in our image? Will it be warlike? Will it be racist? Will it be sexist, right? If we want to create good AI, we first have to fix ourselves. So go ahead, Danny.
Thank you, Jose. I know that we're like, you know, past the hour mark. Do you want to, as we continue answering this Q&A, do you want to drop the survey code?
Yeah, yeah, Danny, if you want to go ahead and drop the survey code, I have one more thing to show everybody. But go ahead and drop it in the chat, Danny. For those of you who are my students, go ahead and click on this link that Danny Juarez is about to drop in the chat. You fill it out only for my students, and then you'll go ahead and get 5 points of extra credit. Awesome. For those of you who are not in my classes, please don't fill it out or don't be trolls.
Thank you, Jose. Did you want to go ahead and move to that one thing you want to show them, or do you want to take another question?
We'll take one more question and then I'll move to the last thing.
Awesome. So let me go ahead and see the next one. Savannah asked, when you think we'll be able to see a person of color reach, they put on here status of Elon Musk, Bill Gates, I'm assuming they mean like wealth and maybe power.
So one of the things that I've been really frustrated with is how a lot of us gravitate towards like the first blank, right? So it's like the first richest Latino, right? The first wealthiest Latino in the world. That's already happened, mind you. That was Carlos Slim in 2010, right? Who is from Mexico. I mean, what's the point of having the richest whatever that looks like you if they're going to behave the same way as the people that oppressed you prior? I want to remind everybody that Hernan Cortez, when he was conquering Mexico in the 1500s, used indigenous people, like indigenous allies, and had indigenous armies to conquer other indigenous communities, right? So, I mean, do you want an oppressor that looks like you? I mean, there were Cherokee slaveholders. And for those of you who don't know, there were also African-American slaveholders, right? So it's kind of like there's this really popular meme where the administration asks, like, do you want more diversity in higher education? And it's like, how about we do no oppressors? And then the administration responds with, why do you hate diversity, right? You really have to stop thinking about it in like what I can see and more in systemic terms. What often happens is identity politics gets co-opted by institutions to oppress you even more and more. So what we really have to do is change systems so that multiple identities can exist. Or for those of you who are aware of the Zapatistas in southern Mexico, in Chiapas, Subcomandante Marcos from the Zapatistas says, we have to build a world where many worlds exist. Un mundo donde quepan muchos mundos. So Yeah, with that, thank you for your final question. What I wanted to show you all now is just a little bit more of art that I did, which I will jump to in a bit. It's 5:11 p.m., everybody. It's time to log off. Have a great weekend. Thank you to everybody who joined in. But all my students, once you do the survey, you're free to go. Thank you, everybody, for coming here and for being bored for an hour. So, órale.